We also have the three co-pastors from Left Hand Church with us, and they will be preaching our sermon today. But I just want to make sure you know who they are to us. All of them started off coming to Highlands Church, and for all three of them, this is the place where they reconnected with God, where they sort of reconnected with their own hearts and a Christian community. And in this place, and actually even before this place, they had a vision from God individually, and it started to come together for them as a trio. And their vision was that they felt like the world needed more churches like Highlands Church. So they stayed here for a few years, sort of soaking in the joy and the goodness and the absolute unconditional love of Christ, and the vision just kept growing. And so we kind of came alongside them in that vision, and they have planted a church that has now been functioning for, I think, 13 months, one whole year, a little bit more than a year. And we've asked them to come back and share a little bit of the vision with us and just reconnect with us personally. So Mark and I have both preached at Left Hand, and many of you have visited there, and some of you still give financially to them. There's so much connection between us that I just wanted you to know how special this relationship is. They are our sister church. And we have other sister churches, several here in Denver and many around the country, but this is different. Like, they are us and we are them, and we will forever be spiritual companions in Christ together as we try to create spaces for a more just and generous version of Christianity. So they're it. They are doing it, and we are so proud of them. Will you help me welcome Left Hand Church's pastors?
I love you guys. Thank you. Thank you, Jenny. I just want to say before we get started how grateful we are to you and what a wonderful thing that Left Hand has become and how life-giving it is for our community. I grew up the oldest child of a pastor. I grew up the oldest grandchild of a pastor. The denomination in which I grew up in is the Nazarene Church, which is a conservative evangelical denomination where everybody knows your name and everybody knows your business from three generations before. I went to a Nazarene college. I married my high school sweetheart. 2 years after we got married, we graduated, moved to Colorado to live the dream. A week after I defended my master's thesis, I gave birth. 2 years after that, I gave birth. 2 years after that, I gave birth. And we settled into the local conservative evangelical megachurch. We did all the right things. And we have three kids within 5 years. It can be a little bit tricky on a marriage, but we did all the things. We stayed in the church. I led the moms group. We showed up and volunteered. We babysat other people's kids. Well, we had children of our own. And then my brother came out as gay. And I did not have a framework in which to figure this out. And so I began a journey of my own to where I could get to a point where I could say to my brother, I love you. Not I love you, but. And it took a while. I can say it probably took about a decade to get to that point. And then sitting in my local evangelical megachurch, I started to feel very uncomfortable. And that discomfort turned into anger, which meant that on the way home from church, driving down Airport Road, it meant my husband got an earful. And I pretty much yelled my way home half the time. And then Michael Brown's death happened in Ferguson, Missouri in August of 2014. And I was like, we are not talking about anything that matters in this place. So what happened, this child of a pastor, grandchild of a pastor, she left church. I didn't know what to do. One weekend, I said the terrible words to a group of friends, I think I need to start a church. A week later, I learned that my favorite preacher at our church, Paul Williams, was now Paula. Paul Williams was a leading church planter in the independent Christian church denomination, and I thought, I finally have access to this person. I reached out to Paula, who lives in my county, and I said, do you have a church? Because that's the one I want to go to. She said, oh no, I don't have a church. So we met for coffee. And I said, okay, since you know what it is like to plant a church, will you help me plant one? And she looked at me across the table. And she said, do not start a church. It will suck your soul. And I said, okay, well, I don't really want to do that anyway. So let's just be friends. So we kept meeting. And we both decided that we were over church. Like, we can do this life without church. We don't need this. And then come spring of 2014, we both looked at each other and said, shoot, we do need church. She learned about Highlands Church from a friend who knew Mark Tidd. And she met with Mark. And that next week, my family and I, we started attending Highlands Church.
Jen Jepsen, pastor of Reconciling Ministries at Left Hand Church. I'm Aaron Bailey, pastor of Executive Ministries at Left Hand Church. And like so many of us, I grew up in the evangelical, non-denominational, Bible-believing, fundamental, just add a bunch more adjectives here, church. And as I grew up, something about that just didn't sit well with me. I remember asking one of my teachers, what would happen if someone in Africa had never heard of Jesus die? What would happen if they die? And my teacher said, well, surely they'd go to hell. And that just didn't sit right with me. It still doesn't sit right with me. So I rebelled. I stopped going to church. I went to a politically conservative college. My senior year, my girlfriend of 2 years asked me why I had never kissed her. And I vaguely remember, thank you, Paula. Triggering moment here. I vaguely remember spouting off some line verbatim from Promise Keepers about saving myself for marriage. but really, I realized at that moment that I was gay. So I did what many of us gay boys do when they're living in rural Michigan and come out of the closet. I moved to New York City. And came blazing out of the closet. But I was done with the church. I didn't know if I could walk into a church and be accepted. So I left it behind. I didn't need that world anymore. I moved from New York to Chicago to Denver about 11 years ago and went through a very painful part of my life. A relationship that I was in for 7 years ended in a very dramatic and toxic way. I was without friends here in this new city. I was depressed. I was lonely. It was a rough time in my life. I was lost. Eventually, I started dating again, and I went on Match.com. Now, for you millennials in the audience, Match.com is like Tinder without the swiping back and forth. I quickly matched with a guy who talked about his faith in his profile. I was intrigued. He was cute. So we set up a coffee date later that week, and over coffee, he told me about this church that he had been attending in the Highlands neighborhood of Denver. We weren't meant to be romantically involved. We were meant to just be friends. We realized that. We're still friends to this day. And 5.5 years ago, I joined him in walking through those doors and into this building. And quite frankly, my life was changed, transformed. This place, this community, you all, have shown me unconditional love. You've shown me that it's okay to be gay and to be a believer. I've been part of a Deepen group for 4 years. I'm still part of that group. I was baptized on this stage. This life, this community really changed my life, and I'm so grateful. Meanwhile, I was going through another transition in my life. I had built a company over the previous 10 years and sold it to a Japanese multinational conglomerate. The plan was to work for the buyer for 2 years, contractually obligated 2 years, and then sell everything else I owned, except for my laptop and maybe some clothes, pack a bag, and go travel around the world, eat, pray, love, tour. You know, it was going to be amazing. Amazing. That year, Mark asked me to speak at the annual Stones of Remembrance service. And also speaking at that service were two women I did not yet know, Jen Jepsen and Paula Williams.
So my name's Paula Williams. I'm the pastor of preaching and worship at Left Hand Church. And my favorite television show of all time was Lost. There came a point in the final season when the protagonist of the show realized he'd been called by God to die. If you're a Lost fan, it was when Jack went to the lighthouse. And when I saw that show, I started sobbing, and I sobbed all the way through the night to the next morning. I screamed and yelled at God, "Who are you to make me this way? Who do you think you are to call me to be who I was?" Because I'd known from the time I was 3 or 4 years of age that I was transgender. The call toward authenticity is sacred and holy and for the greater good. And it asks you to trust that the truth will not only set you free, but it will set everyone free. So I came out. Turns out if you spend most of your life working as a pastor in the conservative religious world, coming out as transgender is not all that good for your career. Who knew? Within 7 days, I lost every single one of my jobs. I thought, I'm done with the church. It's over. Jen Jepsen reached out to me and said, "I think I want to plant a church." I said, "Oh yeah, no, you don't want to do that. It is, in fact, the hardest job on earth." She and Eric started coming here. I had met Mark Tidd, and it was Father's Day, 2015. I sat in the back in the middle. "Reach, let us, in joyful, joyful, we adore thee." And to hear Bach again in the church, I sobbed and sobbed. And as Mark says so often, these floors have been washed with the tears of many. And I knew I'd been called for the second time in my life. This time, called back to the church.
I was really, really hoping that the idea to plant a church would die. I didn't want to do it. We really enjoyed the Highlands community, and it restored my soul. I discovered who I was in light of God's love, and I learned that I didn't have to do anything but be me to be loved here. But I knew that my community in Longmont, specifically Boulder County, needed this too. Our county, for being 330,000 people, has an inordinate number of conservative megachurches. And so in those churches, you're more than welcome to come if you're LGBTQ, but that's about as far as you're gonna get. And so one day I decided I needed to take the pulse of my town. And so I walked up and down the 5 streets that make up the heartbeat of my city. I walked up Terry, down Kaufman, up Main, got some donuts. I walked down Kimbark, and I stopped at 4th and Kimbark. And there's this beautiful turn-of-the-century Presbyterian church right on the corner. And I stood there, and I looked at this church, and I prayed out loud, which I don't really like to do, but thankfully I was alone. I prayed out loud, and I said, "God, if you could make this happen, that would be really great."
So during the 2 years that I was working for the buyer of my company, I was getting heavily involved at Highlands Church as a volunteer leader. Meanwhile, I had this growing knot in my stomach and in my heart that what was here was amazing, but if I looked around the country, very few people have access to a church like Highlands. And that problem gnawed at me. It really made me upset. So the contract to sell my company prematurely ended in about 8 months. So it was a dramatic story. I don't have time to go into it. But I went to Mexico by myself to plan out the Eat, Pray, Love tour. And I brought with me Rob Bell's How to Be Here. And I sat on the beach and read that book and flipped those pages, and it's as if God flipped my life upside down. I promise you there was not a drop of tequila involved. But for the first time in my life, I felt called to go do something to solve that problem of not enough places in this country having access to a church like Highlands. So I paced the beach back and forth. I swore up and down. I schemed ways out of getting out of this calling, but I knew my life was about to be changed. I emailed a bunch of people here at Highlands, set up coffee meetings for when I got back, and started to meet with these people to help me discern what I was supposed to do with this calling. I met with Paula, and she looked me in the eyes across the table and said, "You're supposed to go help us start a church in Longmont, Colorado." So that was step one, and we've been on this journey for a year and a half now. Step two is another organization that I'm just helping to start called Launchpad Partners. We are aiming to train and equip and support leaders from around the country who are starting inclusive churches like Highlands, like Left Hand Church. We're just getting started. Thank you. Thank you. I'm really excited about this. Just getting started on this this organization, fundraising currently, and I've already talked to a dozen or so leaders from around this country, even in the last 6 weeks, and a good number of megachurch pastors who have quit, and they're fed up with the toxic theology, and after some time of discernment, they want to go start churches like Highlands.
So 10 weeks after my very first week sitting in the middle in the back, I was up here preaching and joined the preaching team here at Highlands, and then just 2 years later had the opportunity to work here for the summer while Jenny was on sabbatical. I was going to help this congregation start its first new church because planting churches is what I had done for 35 years. I'd gone to a tiny church planting organization and had seen it grown to become a national and international organization over the 35 years I was there, which is truly amazing because I started when I was 5. I had incredible skill as this very, very young child because I don't want you doing the math. So excitedly, we worked with the leadership council here and began to look at starting a new church. We began to look at the people who could start it, and I did talk to Aaron about it. And of course, Jen from the beginning was the heart of the idea. And then one day I sat with Mark Tidd for the second time at the coffee shop. If Mark invites me to that particular coffee shop, I always get nervous. And he said, "I think you have been called to minister to this church." I said, "Yeah, but I've promised to help you, to help Highlands get to the point of being able to start this church." He said, "Yeah, you know, I think God can probably take care of us. And I think God has called you to be a part of that church." And for the third time in my life, I knew I had been called. And I knew we could not do it alone. Paul was with Timothy on one of his missionary journeys. He'd gone from city to city to city telling the good news about Jesus. And he kept getting stopped from going into this country or that country or another country. And one night, frustrated, he's in his dreams when he has a vision of a man in Macedonia who said, "Come over and help us." First thing the next morning, they headed down to the sea and they traveled to the region of Macedonia. And there they took the gospel of Jesus. And so the three of us knew we needed help. And so with the help of Highlands, we also recruited Denver Community Church and Forefront Church in Brooklyn, New York. We invited two of your leaders onto our leadership council, Joe Quillen and Vernon Duggar. It's the best we could do. You got to take what you can get. We also took leadership council members from Denver Community Church, took them from Forefront Church, and they remain with us on our leadership council. And then we recruited 2 and now 4 people from our own church to be a part of that leadership council. We began raising money, and by far you gave the most money to us to get started. And then we called to you, and we said to you, "Come help us in Macedonia. Come and be a part of this new church. We began our very first services once a month in January and February last year. And then we started into weekly services in March. We needed your help, and so many of you came and worshiped with us on a Saturday night. From the beginning, our worship was patterned almost exactly after yours. And Heather Lynn is, in fact, our worship minister. We've got her every single Saturday at 5 o'clock, and we love it. Worship last night was amazing. Oh, it was so much fun. And I got to preach last night. You should have been there. You can watch it online. Just go to YouTube, look for Left Hand Church, or go to Facebook and look for Left Hand Church. You can see all of our sermons online, and we do something special. We also have a tune at the end of each sermon that is, in fact, Heather Lynn singing, and you can also see that online. So if you don't want to watch Jen or me preach, you can just forward through all that stuff and go straight to Heather Lynn. So we started our services, and we've grown and grown and grown. And now we're a congregation of about 125, 130 people. We have somewhere between 60 and 80 on any given Saturday night. Almost all of them are from Boulder County. This past weekend, we had our first retreat ever as a church in Estes Park. 30 of us got together, and it's another church whose floors are washed with the tears of those who've been excluded from the churches of their youth. We had an incredible weekend together as we see our congregation develop its culture of inclusiveness, its culture of joy, its culture focused on reconciliation, its culture focused on being like Christ in the place where we live. And none of it would have happened without you. As we move forward, we still have needs. Thank goodness we have Vernon Duggar and we have Trevor who come up and work with our teen program, but we've got a lot of kids and a lot of teenagers, and so we need to expand our youth program, our teen program. We have a lot of young children, too. There's so many opportunities of growth for us. We'd like to start Sunday morning services because we're getting close to the point where we really need to be able to do that. God has blessed us because you chose to bless us at Left Hand Church.
A number of months after I prayed that funny little prayer in front of that Presbyterian church, they opened their doors wide to us. They said, "We need you in our community, and we want you here, and we will support you how you need." And they are extending, helping us in partnership extend the goodness of God's love to all people into Longmont and Boulder County. And every week, Saturday night, around 5:20 p.m., we say the words.
Married, divorced, and single here. It's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big and small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt and believe here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ and straight here, there is no hate here. Woman, non-binary, and man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, let us live and love without labels. Amen. Will you pray with me? God, you made us as tribal people, as a species that thrives only in the context of other species, and only in the context of community within our own. You created us with a need to worship, and a need to worship together. You created within us the capacity to join together as a group and bring all of our flawed bodies and personalities and quirks and pull them together into one group that occasionally, on its better days, looks amazingly like Jesus. Thank you for the genius of the church, Thank you for this church that's led not only ours, but literally scores and scores of others throughout the United States as we all learn to grow, to embrace everyone in the journey of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. For this we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.